Hi, everyone. Today, our topic will be basic SIP telephony integration with CUCM. SIP integration can be one of the most challenging aspects of QSIS. In the quantum introduction to SIP telephony topic, we discuss the underlying technology of SIP telephony, but in this section, we'll look at SIP telephony from a more practical angle. In this lecture, we'll integrate the QSIS soft phone with a real SIP proxy to get a deeper understanding of the typical setup of the proxy itself and what we need to know about that setup to be successful in registering and making calls. In this particular case, we'll explore the methods for integrating the QSIS soft phone to Cisco Unified Communications Manager, or CUCM. We'll test this integration by making test calls to and from a QSIS system with a soft phone application running on a PC. Keep in mind, the topology here is greatly simplified from an actual enterprise VoIP deployment, but the basic concept shown here should apply to any running CUCM implementation. In this diagram, we have a couple of basic devices: a server running Cisco Call Manager, CUCM, a core, a laptop running a soft phone, and a network Ethernet switch connecting it all together. In your network, you may have additional devices like routers and firewalls not pictured here. The steps will be as follows. The first step for most SIP telephony endpoints is to register with the SIP proxy. In this case, CUCM checks the credentials of each endpoint and responds accordingly. The endpoints can make calls when and only when they're registered with the call manager. We'll discover that different methods are required to interface QSIS to CUCM depending on the number of QSIS soft phones required in your project. In this workshop, we're going to focus on single soft phone registration. In future workshops, we'll address multiple soft phones and SIP trunking with CUCM. The scenarios described here are specific to CUCM. Other systems have different ways of handling these implementations and will be discussed in other trainings. The steps to configure an account in CUCM for the QSIS soft phone are as follows. First, we create the security profile that will be used for the soft phone. Next, we create the end user profile that includes the credentials the soft phone will use to register. Finally, we create the phone definition, which consists of a device and an associated directory number. The directory number is the phone number used for the soft phone. Let's look at each step in detail. When one and only one soft phone is required in a given QSIS design, it's typically registered as a third-party SIP device basic. Each SIP endpoint in CUCM requires licensing credits, and this is the least expensive option. The very first part of defining the soft phone in CUCM is to create a phone security profile. The items to note here pertinent to the QSIS configuration are the name, the transport type, digest authentication, and SIP phone port. We'll go over these one by one. First, the security profile needs a name. This name can be whatever you want, but it will be used later, so remember the name you used. The transport type determines whether QSIS should use the UDP or TCP network transport for SIP messages to and from CUCM. Remember, this determines the behavior of the signaling plane, the call control messages, but not the audio transport used to send and receive audio. Digest authentication is the name of the method the QSIS soft phone uses to validate its username and password with CUCM. This is the only authentication method supported by QSIS. The SIP phone port sets the UDP-TCP port number used to interface to the soft phone. Port 5060 is the standard port number, but it can be manually changed by the system administrator. Our next step is to configure an end user. This screen allows us to configure a user ID and password for authentication. The user ID in the end user setup corresponds to the authentication username in the QSIS soft phone setup. The tricky part is the password immediately below this user ID is not the authentication password. It's also not the PIN below that. The last name field doesn't really do anything, but it needs to be filled in, so we can just use QSIS as the last name. Instead, the authentication password is set in the digest credentials field. That may not seem incredibly intuitive, but remember that we enabled digest authentication, so it makes sense that the soft phone is using digest authentication to register. The final step is to configure a phone device of the correct type tied to that user account. We see here the device is set up as a basic third-party SIP device. There are a large number of settings on the device screen, so if you're following along on your own CUCM, scroll down to see the settings above. Here, we see the device type again, along with the user ID in the owner field. The owner user ID is the same as you configured earlier in the end user config, and also corresponds to the authentication username on the core, which we'll see later. There's also an entry for device pool here, which is set to default. This is a more advanced setting, but it controls which CUCM servers the device can register to, and also access to things like media resources. Check with your CUCM administrator regarding appropriate device pool settings for your implementation. In the protocol specific information at the bottom of this page, we assign the device security profile we created before. The SIP profile controls all of the basic SIP parameters for this phone. Most of the time, those do not need to be modified unless requested by a network administrator. The standard SIP profile should work with our soft phone, but if needed, you can copy the standard profile and create a separate QSIS SIP profile and assign it instead. We also specify the digest user we created for this account. We also have a field here for media termination point required. This is for scenarios where you might be using G729 to interface to CUCM, but CUCM is using G711 to talk to the wider telephone network. This is called transcoding, and if calls aren't working, it's something to check. This might even be required if different DTMF methods are being used in the network. When you're done with the configuration, you should click Save and Apply Config. Otherwise, this configuration could be lost and is not active yet. The next step is to associate a directory number with the device. From the top of the device screen, click on Add a New DN on the upper left. The directory number is the first field and represents the phone extension. This will normally be a 4-digit number, but it depends on your configuration. In the Associated Devices section, you would use the MAC address of the device from our previous step. CUCM sometimes fills this in automatically. Now, if you go back to the device, you'll see the directory number associated with the device. Now that the account is set up in CUCM, we turn our attention to the setup in QSIS Core Manager. First and foremost, we must confirm the core network configuration. We want to make sure the correct QSIS NIC is connected to the VoIP network and the correct IP address options are chosen. We spent a substantial amount of time on this in the networking sections of Quantum Training, so we'll trust that you know how to accomplish this. The next step is to confirm the shared settings for all soft phones. In this setup, we'll use LAN A as the VoIP interface. The SIP signaling port is set to 5060, which again is the default. We saw this in the CUCM setup. This is the SIP signaling port for the core and is used for incoming calls to the core. The port used for outgoing calls to talk to CUCM is set later. SIP logging here is enabled, which will be a useful troubleshooting tool if we run into problems. By default, this is disabled. The rest of the shared settings we covered in Quantum Training before, but a quick refresh of the typical settings is shown. SRTP is normally disabled. DTMF info is disabled as well. CUCM does not typically use these methods. The DTMF type is also fine for this application. Stun is also disabled. This applies mostly to hosted SIP solutions when the core is behind a firewall, which is not the case here. Now let's look at the individual soft phone settings. The proxy field specifies the address of the CUCM server. In some scenarios, a network can have more than one CUCM server. In redundant proxy applications, there's a backup proxy field to point to the secondary unit. By default, the proxy is using port 5060, but if you need a different port, you can append it to the proxy IP with a colon port number. In this case, we do want to register with the proxy. Most systems require this level of security, including this one. The transport settings select the method of SIP communication required for CUCM. In this case, you'll remember that CUCM was set to use UDP. This could also be TCP, depending on the configuration. We now move to the individual account settings we set in CUCM. The username field represents the subscriber number assigned in CUCM. These two fields must match or we will not be able to register. The authentication ID represents the digest username in the end user account setup. Remember, The password represents the digest credentials in the end user account setup, not the password or PIN fields. This is very important to remember. And voila! Provided all these items are correct, the soft phone is registered. Success! Wait, what? CUCM tells us in the soft phone status we have a fault. This leads us to an important piece of trivia about CUCM. The authentication username is case sensitive. Note, the cases shown do not match. Correcting this will finally result in a successful registration. We covered the details of how registration occurs during quantum training, but as a refresher, here's an example of a successful registration that you would see in Wireshark if you grabbed a packet capture from the core. Once we correct this, the OK status indicates the soft phone is registered and ready to make calls. We see green in the soft phone status block, and we know that's good. Now, let's try to make a test call. Now we can dial our computer soft phone at extension 2001. The soft phone is answered, and we see the soft phone in the connected state. We hang up, and the call disconnects as expected. The test call was a success. Let's look at that exchange between the different peers who participated in the call. Sometimes everything looks correct with our configuration in the core and CUCM, and things still don't work. There are a few other common things to check. If you go back to CUCM, make sure that under the device configuration that we didn't miss configuring a digest user. It's down pretty far in the configuration, so sometimes it's easy to miss. Also, go back and check again that enable digest authentication is checked. Also, easy to forget, and nothing will work if the box isn't checked. When we look at this interaction, it's easy to see the role of the proxy server in call setup. We see an interaction between QSYS and CUCM. Then, we also see an interaction between CUCM and the peer we're calling. The key takeaway here is that the proxy server acts as the traffic cop between the peers. The direct interaction between them comes only after the session is negotiated by CUCM. Let's analyze the traffic flow from end to end to understand the process. At the very first, we see the QSYS soft phone invites the destination to a call by contacting CUCM. CUCM then issues a challenge to authenticate before passing along the invite to the destination. The QSYS soft phone issues a new invite message with the encrypted password in response. This is where we'll start charting the exchange between all the devices involved. The new invite message is received by CUCM. It includes the Session Description Protocol, or SDP, information so that CUCM knows what audio formats and codecs it supports. SDP also contains information about which IP addresses will be sending and receiving RTP and which network ports to use for RTP. If SDP is included in the invite, this is called the early offer method. CUCM in turn invites the far end, extension 2001. Since 2001 is another phone registered with CUCM, it knows how to reach that peer where the QSYS soft phone would not. CUCM replies to QSYS to say, trying, which means, I'm working on it. And then the destination in turn replies with, I'm working on it, and then with ringing to let CUCM know that it's prompted the user of that phone to answer. CUCM then passes that along so that the QSYS soft phone can notify the user that the far end is ringing. This notification is also what triggers the caller to hear ringing. The destination responds with an OK. This includes the SDP information about which codec the call will be using for that leg of the call. The leg between CUCM and the destination may not use the same codec that's used between the QSYS soft phone and CUCM. This is called transcoding. CUCM compares the codec list to our initial offer in the invite. It sends a message with the highest priority match for both peers. QSYS then acknowledges that codec selection and SDP information. Amongst other information included in the session description protocol is the contact information, IP addresses, port numbers, etc., for the other end of the call. This now allows the peers to exchange audio directly with each other. The peers start to exchange audio and begin the call in earnest. This isn't included in the flow diagram, as the capture was taken on the machine hosting CUCM. These packets would only be seen on a capture from QSYS or the destination. Note that any in-call DTMF would be handled as RTP event type messages directly between peers. They would show up in the RTP flow as well. After a few seconds in call, the QSYS soft phone ends the call. We see this as a bye message. Note, this goes back to CUCM rather than directly to the far end of the call. CUCM then forwards the bye message to the far end. If the other side hangs up, the bye messages would flow in the other direction. The far end responds with an OK that is also passed from CUCM to the QSYS softphone. Now we've seen the SIP account created in CUCM and QSYS, and we've seen how the data from the CUCM account setup fits in the softphone configuration. We've conducted a simple analysis of the registration process and the process of making a call. Next, let's take a look at some other issues that can occur. Other status messages on your softphone may appear. Two common ones are registration timeout and service unavailable. Registration timeout means that the core did not get a response from CUCM. This might be a network issue or the wrong IP address. Service unavailable means that registration couldn't happen. This might mean that digest authentication is not turned on or that CUCM is not accepting registrations for another reason. A codec mismatch means that both sides could not agree on a codec to use. Let's go through these one by one and learn how to identify and fix them. First, let's learn how to turn on logging and find the logs on the core. In Core Manager, under the Softphone tab, click on Edit and then Enable Logging, and then click Save. This will turn on logging so that we can see what's happening on the core in real time. We can see messages between the core and the proxy, including registration attempts and calls that we place. Then, open a browser window, and for the URL, use the IP address of the core, followed by /sip.txt. An example would be in the format http://192.168.0.23/sip.txt. This will open the SIP logging page where we can see messages between the proxy and the core. This log can also be used to view SIP calls when they're placed. The log does not automatically update, so refresh to see new messages. Now that we've got logging turned on, let's look at some things that you might see. Let's recall that in the core, we had to specify a proxy IP address. However, sometimes we see a registration failed, service unavailable, or request timeout in the softphone status after we complete our configuration. There could be a couple of reasons. One reason might be is that the proxy is not reachable on the LAN interface we picked earlier. If we enable logging on the softphone and look at our sip.txt file, we may see the message above. We see where we sent a message to the IP address of the proxy and got a request timeout because we got no response. If this happens, check with your network administrator to make sure the core is using the correct LAN interface and that you have the correct IP address for CUCM. Let's go back and look at another possible issue. The username in the softphone refers to an extension configured on the call manager. They must match or the softphone will not register. If 1001 is not a valid extension on the call manager, we'll see a not found error when the softphone tries to register. Here, we see that message in the softphone block as our status. If we go back to CUCM, in this example, we see that we have a directory number of 2010, which does not match what we configured on the core manager. If we correct them so both sides match, then we should be able to register. If we place a call, we may see this message in the softphone block. What does this mean? Well, let's take a look at the sip.txt log and see what it shows. The sip.txt log shows us this. This means that we tried to set up a call using a codec that CUCM doesn't have enabled. So go back to Core Manager and try enabling all codecs if they aren't already and try the call again. Also, make sure that SRTP isn't accidentally checked while UDP is being used. SRTP should only be checked if TLS is also checked. That's it for basic SIP registration with CUCM. In future trainings, we will discuss advanced registration on CUCM with multiple softphones and SIP trunking for CUCM.